Hello everyone. Today in series of Docplexus KOL interviews, we have with us Dr. Dinesh Dhanwal, who heads the Department of Endocrinology, Diabetology and Metabolic Disorders at NMC Specialty Hospital, Abu Dhabi. He has led and participated in over 10 clinical trials and has also written over 50 research papers. Thank you so much, sir, for this interview. How are you feeling today?
My pleasure to be with Docplexus, Ms. Ania. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Oh no, absolutely. Yeah. Thank you so much again. And let me start by asking you some of the questions that our viewers would love to hear your opinions on. In your vast opinion, what would you say is the role of vitamin D in patients with hypothyroidism?
So, Sanya, we did a couple of studies. In fact, this was the first study we did in the world where we showed that vitamin D deficiency, if it is there in patients with hypothyroidism, then these patients have their bone density is much lower than the group which do not have vitamin D deficiency. So from this point, the whole story started that if you give vitamin D in these patients with hypothyroidism, then we can bring their BMD better than without giving vitamin D. So we followed up this study with vitamin D supplement, and we showed that yes, you can improve bone health by giving vitamin D supplements in patients who have vitamin D deficiency and hypothyroidism. And then another study we did where we gave, without doing vitamin D levels, we just gave one group vitamin D irrespective whether they were deficient or not. And there also we showed that vitamin D, if you give supplement in and just a small dose, maybe 50,000 units or 60,000 per month, can make bones better. So in my opinion, I think now in my clinical practice, what I'm doing, even if I do not have vitamin D levels, which it is some small group of patients, then we are supplementing with small dose of vitamin D and we are getting better results for their bone density. So I think this is a huge gain for patients hypothyroidism.
And now talking more about hypothyroidism, what would you say, how is hypothyroidism a risk factor in deep vein thrombosis?
Okay, this is again, see, hyperthyroidism, we have, there is changes in the coagulation profile, and there is even increase in the platelet aggregation, which predisposes these patients for deep vein thrombosis. And we had a couple of papers and case reports, and one of my colleagues, Dr. Gupta, he did a study on this aspect, and we have shown that the hyperthyroidism is a hypercoagulable state, and we should keep that in mind. I think that should be enough. So if you have a patient with hyperthyroidism, on treatment he gets deep vein thrombosis or other thrombotic state, so just be aware that this can be just part of the hyperthyroidism and we have to treat as per our guidelines.
Absolutely. And how would you say bone mineral density affected in hypothyroidism?
See, hyperthyroidism is a resorptive state. There is increased resorption of calcium from bone, and these patients have, this is not a new thing. Starting from almost 100 years ago, the bones of patients who had hyperthyroidism, very severe, it was very brittle, like they call it moth-bitten appearance of the wow. bones. So from there, then they have multiple studies over last 30, 40 years, and it is very clear that patients with hyperthyroidism, they have reduced bone density. And when we treat them, this improves, because most of these patients are young. But in case elderly population has hyperthyroidism, then the risk of not only BMD will reduce, and that's a major risk factor for osteoporotic fractures like hip fracture or spine fracture. So we have to keep that in mind. So there is no doubt hyperthyroidism is a osteoporotic state. And as I told you, we have to, first treatment is with the treatment of hyperthyroidism. But the residual things we can improve by giving them vitamin D, and rarely we have to give anti-resorptive medications.
Could you please share with us your experience while dealing with the case of hypophysitis?
Oh yes, hypophysitis, I think while back home in India, because we were in the tertiary care, GB Pant and Lok Nayak Hospital. So we used to get, I'll say once a month or so, one case in 4 to 6 weeks we used to get. And these patients, some of these patients were referred from neurosurgery. They were being prepared for surgery and they were sending us to us for preoperative assessment and preoperative for surgery clearance. And looking at MRI, see, I think with the experience one can see, when you look at the MRI images of, so you can very well differentiate whether it is pituitary adenoma or hypophysitis, plus the biochemical profile. So the most common hormone which goes down in hypophysitis cortisol. So these patients are ACTH deficiency, cortisol deficiency, and you can pick up them by clinical and imaging. And treatment is, I think, very dramatic. In case they have mass effects, we give them glucocorticoids for a span of 4 to 6 weeks. And with that, the size of pituitary gland comes down very, very significantly. But yes, but these patients can have later on hypopituitarism, which we can always replace. So hypophysitis is like we have Hashimoto's thyroiditis, where there is lymphocytic infiltration. Here also there is lymphocytic infiltration. It destroys the pituitary cells and patient ultimately goes into hypopituitarism. But most importantly, we have to differentiate whether it is pituitary adenoma, because the pituitary adenoma treatment may be surgery. So if we can diagnose as hypophysitis, then we can save these patients from surgery, which is a very big thing.
And how does maternal long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acid status in pregnancy influence bone health of children?
Yeah, see, this is one of the, way back in 2009 to 10, I was with that MRC, University of Southampton, with Professor Cyrus Cooper. And I was part of one of these studies, I'll not say study, but part of at least publication, where we analyze the data. They have an ongoing study on fetal origin of heart of adult diseases. So right now they have a cohort, large cohort of pregnant women whom they delivered, and their children are growing now. So they had everything from those pregnant women, their serum levels. So what they correlated in that particular study, what we did, we correlated the pupa levels and the children's bone health, and there was a significant correlation. And this I presented in American Society of Bone Mineral Research in Toronto a few years ago, and this was one of the awarded posters there.
Wow, congratulations. Thank you so much, sir, for giving us this opportunity to hear your opinions. I'm very sure our audience is going to greatly benefit after hearing some of your invaluable perspectives.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.